four brothers. Saffan. Bagan. Under. And Ufla, bound by eternal purpose. And a girl named Mo. Has learned to sleep under the hissing tubes and the ever-humming chambers. The pumping cylinders give her comfort, the drumming of a job well done. Nothing startles her more than silence. There is no rest for the apprentice. Moore has done so much around here, repaired and watched and built, but in this deathly silence, she is once more taunted by the one thing she will never be able to do. Their engineering can be studied and replicated, but their strength they selfishly keep. Despite all the wiring and the manufactured tubes, the engines are powered by physical force. but the kind that no mere human could ever muster. He was always the weakest of the four. He is struggling to breathe. Even Maul can taste the stale air in her mouth. It seems the ventilation system isn't working properly, but nothing does without the engine. Without power, the observatory is not much use. Like a punch to the chest. It is all four of them. They all broke at the same time. Failed at the same time. Something grave must have occurred. But what? Without the veil, the air is too toxic to breathe. And just as Maul feared, the vents have all shut. The poison is kept out, but so is the oxygen. Safan is slowly suffocating, and the other three may have it worse. It shows all three purifiers are down, as if more needed any confirmation beyond the spores in the air. This is on you, Safon, Mo grunts. Pray it is not too late for me to fix your mess. Thank you. smell made it clear. It died a long time ago. And now, the spores are taking hold of whatever remains. A better fate than the fungus eating you alive. Do not worry. I will fix your mess, and I will save our homes, Moore reassures herself. She knows the damage the spores are capable of. The fungus first poisoning the mind, then ever so slowly consuming the body. How it will spoil the verdant soil and obscure the midday sun. Despite all of its dangers, Moore frequently inhales the poison. An occupational hazard, she calls it. A sacrifice others weren't willing to make. A few violent coughs, a few eerie apparitions. Won't keep her from doing her job. After all, she is the bearer of the Omniswitch. Once a bustling place, before the great exodus. Now just a pile of broken things and abandoned ideas. The island hosts the purifiers, guarding Safan's domain. And not much else anymore. Sea berries fills her nostrils, or is it a scent lingering in her memories? Estate. He should be inside, with the windows shut and doors locked. Moore's heart skips a beat. Either the fungus got to him, or he is somewhere out there, fiddling with the purifiers himself. Moore's uncle owned this place. He still somehow does. One ride was 2 coins, back when money still meant something. It is resting, waiting for a spark. Her uncle always told stories about his big plans, how people would come from far-off lands. He spent all his fortune on his dream. All that's left is the rot in the jars. Take a deep breath. The air still tastes foul, but the acrid poison is mostly gone. Two more to go. these masks, the people who once wore them, the lingering memories of people, in one way or another, now gone. He didn't want kids sneaking around, breaking things, or adults stealing things. But more was always welcome here. More was family. Heat on her tongue and fingers as she snuck a taste of the steaming sweet-sour jam. For weeks after, she'd carry a little teaspoon so she wouldn't have to wash her hands. Thank you. Moore remembers the first time she saw the farmer, singing a song as he lit a candle by this tree. She didn't understand what he meant until later. That things are only gone when they are forgotten. The old man and his locks, protecting his property, as if a crowd might wander once again. Moore takes in the sour scents of the fermented berries, deeply curious to know their taste. Remembers excitedly showing everyone who would humor her the sounds and rhythms of the machine underneath the land. Her uncle always stayed the longest, watching her face light up the little dark holes inside. The old wood groans, dreaming of past revolutions, resolute to be a solution once more, before turning to dust. The berry farmer sighs, exhausted from his struggle. Living things are his purview, not machines. So for all his troubles, all his striving to fix the machine, it simply bore no fruit. Moore frowns. Her frustration growing. She warned him not to toy with the machines. Moore's uncle huffs, disappointed at his niece's rudeness. For heaven's sake, was I meant to just watch as the poisonous dust slowly settled around my island? He was meant to stay inside and wait for her to be done. His heroics were simply unneeded. Like the old man didn't touch anything important. Relief washes over her uncle at the sight of her success. Feeling thankful and a little ashamed, he offers some seaberry wine as reconciliation. He hands over his key, a sign of his trust, and asks her to fetch them a bottle of his finest, the one tucked away in the shed. Maybe she is being too harsh on her uncle. He is only trying to help, after all. Moore considers the bottle in her hands and spending a small moment with the farmer. But too many lives are in danger. Too many things are at stake. The glass will simply have to wait. To keep little trinkets in this hole, until the day she reached a little too far. Her uncle always laughs as he retells the story of the proudest fish he caught, the moor. Thank you. rotten wood creaks in hunger, seeking, ready to devour. She whispers. I just need to keep moving. It's not my first time doing this. A few violent coughs, a few eerie apparitions. She has been sent to these places before. She has trained herself to escape. She just has to remember the tune. Thank you. been okay, she tells herself, but it feels more real than ever. Someone is shouting. I'm okay, she replies. I'm okay, she lies. He is glad that he found her, and he laughs off his worry for now. But unvoiced irritation sticks in his throat. He knows she will downplay it. It is routine now, the arguments they have had on repeat, about her hypocritical ways, how she doesn't wear a mask when she forces others to, how she poisons herself. He settles instead for just a few words of concern. Be careful, he smiles. Please come back in one piece. And don't forget to see after your sister. She pretends to not hear him. Bourne and Bever are cleansed, but the batteries won't last. It's time for Zafar to do his part. The children used to all come here together. Miri, Moore, their friends, for the Seaberry Jam, the scarecrows and the rides. And then the exodus happened. With the spores gone, the air is allowed back in, and so is she. When they gave her the Omni Switch, they honored and bound her, the human they chose as their apprentice, now tasked to save them all. Thank you. Empty. Somewhere deep in this labyrinth, the power lines are cut. Power should flow through this capacitor, but it's not finding its way here. The brothers may be old, but they are not immortal, and neither are you. What will be left of you when you're gone? Only dust and crumbling bones. The fuses blew out. Of course. A death sentence. That's what every plant brought down here will find. Things don't flower this deep underground. They wither. You can feel it yourself, can't you? Slumber, and Beva and Born from a poisonous death. Safan can't keep this up for long. Not without his brothers. Thought is pricking Moore's mind. Check on your sister, her uncle said. Despite the coming fight she can already see, the coming fight they always have, Moore will have to go home. Not just for Brother Bagan, but her sister Miri too. The smell, but it's clear now that she has an extra passenger, a hidden creature, smelling of rotting prey and wet fur. Mo stares at the creature, assessing its glare. She won't start a fight. She has no time to nurse an injury. It's not even doing anything. It's just sitting around. Agreed to stay back home, whenever Moore needed to go below. But more and more frequently, the only thing left at home are fights. Miri fails to grasp the importance of Moore's work. Who else could do the things her sister has to do? Instead of valuing Moore's sacrifice, Miri is just being a burden. Miri has been diligently growing crops ever since Moore could remember. No blight could take her down. She'd always start anew. There would be lines each month for the fresh harvest. Moore can hear the silence under the island's crust. Machines aching, begging her to fix them. Which one are you? Paolo? Rudy? Maybe Juno? Miri named every chicken, but they all look the same to Mo. Does the world have to end for you to come and visit me? Miri jokes at her younger sister, her sarcasm masking her disappointment. Miri tries to reach through and speaks earnestly. It's nice to see you, Moore. I missed you. And she asks Moore to come in for stew. But as if unjustly charged for a crime, Moore defends herself, pushing Miri away. I only came to make sure that you're doing okay. Miri nods. She spent all morning trying to bring her animals inside. She reaches out once more to Moore. I can help you. I'll get ready and I'll come too. No, Moore cuts her off. I'm quicker without you tagging along. I got this. You take care of your chickens. They used to be our chickens. Miri snaps in frustration. You used to care. What even am I to you? For Moore, it's just another confrontation on the island's surface. Another angry outburst from her irate sister, making Moore long for the calm and dark below. But for Miri, it is one more ill-fated attempt to get her sister back. If you leave now, I won't be here when you get back. I mean it this time. That one is Fridolin, Moore recalls. The one that runs away. Fridolin will escape again, but he just needs his own space. Moore can sympathize with that. Miri prefers her tea dark and bitter, to wake her in the early hours. Mo would much rather sleep in and stuff herself with the sugary walnut cookies. Mo remembers watching the stars streak across the sky. Miri's face lit by the moonlight, full of wonder, both wrapped up warm in their duvets, their shared silence saying everything they needed. Miri retrained herself to play the cello after the fungus ate her arm. Moore never found the right moment to say how impressed she was. Moore hated the rust bucket of a bath, but it was still preferable to cutting your feet on the rocky beach again. Moore and Miri had a system for the beds, but now, Miri always sleeps on the top bunk. Thank you. Moore had always found small spots comforting. Young Moore would squeeze herself into little caves and find their hidden secrets. Few others are interested in such mundane mysteries. I won't be here when you come back. I'll leave you on this forsaken piece of rock. How many times has Miri threatened to disappear, not once going through with her word? She always comes around in the end. For a moment, Moore regrets not going back to get her mask, but she's never been one for moving backwards. Even in this vision, conjured by the fungus in her lungs, the way out is forward. The lighthouse that once brought travelers home, trade to these islands, and customers to the tavern, now stands still. Before she left, the lightkeeper's wife loved to paint. Moore always admired her skill. Her things were left behind in haste, and he never touched them since. Moore can see Heimer from here. She wonders if the lights are on in their tiny house. Gate to the lighthouse. As long as Moore can remember, the lightkeeper was always on duty, saving sailors from the sharp rocks surrounding these islands. But since the Great Exodus, he has been drowning, touching glasses with whatever phantoms are left at that watering hole. steep slope awaits inside the cave. Its ground was a friendly acquaintance to many drunk patrons. Have some stew. She remembers playing with his son, how they would swim between the rocks, how his wife would bring them inside and warm them up with a bowl of soup and her smile. Moore wonders if he remembers too. Only a ghostly murmur from under his mask, and a ghastly stench. A key, glimmering in his satchel. Thank you. hole in the floor, too big for one man to fill alone, a gaping maw, slowly devouring both man and lighthouse. And still, he stubbornly refuses to accept anyone's help. Nostalgia sharply tugs at Moore's heart. I forgot how much I missed the sky and stars. His wife wouldn't risk losing the boy to the blight, but he decided to remain this island's lightkeeper, unable to bear losing what purpose he thought he had. So they set sail without a father.
Thank you.
gentle vertigo crawls over Moore's body, the satisfying tingle of light danger, one of her favorite sensations. Moore takes in a final breath of Leusa's air. Much better, she congratulates herself. Now your chickens can come back out, sister. She does not expect gratitude from her sister, or an apology, but Moore does expect to be welcomed home. Now that the air is safe to breathe again, Miri must have calmed down and gone to make sure that the stew is still warm. Food is always her way of apologizing. Bergan's muscles soon will power these engines again. It is his duty, and his duty alone, to keep the veil over Haima strong. Mor will make sure he honors it. All the minutes you have squandered and misused for sentimental distractions. How will you make up for everything you have wasted?
Thank you.
Dead things in frames. A petty attempt at preserving beauty. How can you occupy yourself with that? With the lives depending on you? You are beyond these tools now, so primitive and human. You are the bearer of the Omniswitch. But deep down, you know and understand. You are far from worthy of it.
Hey!
Maud doesn't dare to read it. What possible use could reading it have right now? It's all been said, not by the letter or its contents, but by the gemstone left behind. Annoyed, Maud steels herself once more for the visions. These feverish dreams have never been so frequent, never been so hostile. Thank you. Mo hasn't seen her grandmother for a while now, but Granny would never make a scene about it. Yet Mo feels anxious stopping by, not because she doesn't like her. She likes the old woman too much. The deep waters around this island change colour every season, teeming with life of the most curious creatures. The ventilation system grew through her house, wrecking her bedroom, study, and kitchen. She could have moved away, but she wasn't willing to concede a single inch. Hopefully, she hasn't blocked the valve with her morbid laboratory. Miri is not here, the old woman says, but that is not why you've come. Mo tries to tell her how dire it is, how Under and the others have succumbed, how she needs to do what must be done. But her grandmother merely smirks behind her mask. Now look at you. How important you've become. People are counting on you. Yes, yes. Another chuckle behind the air filter. I have something very important for you to do as well. Would you be so kind as to do me a favor? A favor, she calls it. It may as well be an order. Granny has always had her way of getting what she wants. Old companions, the grandmother says, that I have held on to quite long enough. It's time to bring them home. Promise me. Moore's heart plunged into her stomach. She knew what Granny was implying. You do not decline a request like this, Moore promised. Grandma was never interested in anything made by the giants. Lifeless metals and cold steel, she called it. She preferred spending time with the fungus, breeding colorful, voracious new strains. Moore had always looked up to her grandmother, devoting her hours to caring for the dead and the living alike. an enigmatic and stubborn woman who was far smarter than many assumed. Memorfesti and Graba are connected by a bridge that Moore has never fully crossed. The walk always seemed too long, and what lies beyond is what she dreads most. Just the one. You can go back now, Mo. You did the work. You could just tell the old woman off. It's not like you're her servant. Yes, of course, you promised. She was asking too much. Your grandmother doesn't care about your struggles. That old hag. Throw the figures into the sea. And just say you returned them. With a little disrespect for the dead. If it saves the living. Moore's hand clutches the gemstone in her pocket, left behind by her older sister. Her heart is drowning in a deluge of goodbyes, all of them equally real in Miri's unread letter. more expected Kaba to be swallowed by the spores. So this episode comes as no surprise. However, she did not expect to feel so at home here.
Thank you.